Most of this class, we've been talking about derivatives. Today, we're going to talk about antiderivatives. So if you have two functions, and one of them is the derivative of the other, so a little f is the derivative of a big f, then you're used to saying that little f is the derivative of a big f. Well, that's what I just said. And most of the problems that you've done so far in this class is somebody has handed you big f and said, what's little f? But there are a lot of problems that come up in the real world that are the opposite. Somebody hands you little f, and you have to figure out what big F is. In which case, big F is called the antiderivative of little f because you're doing everything in reverse. So for example, cosine of x is the derivative of sine of x, so sine is the antiderivative of cosine. 2x is the derivative of x squared, so x squared is the antiderivative of 2x. But the derivative of x squared plus 7 is also 2x. So x squared plus 7 is also an antiderivative to 2x. So here we had a situation where I gave you little f, and there were two different possibilities for big F. In fact, there are more possibilities. X squared plus 12, or x squared minus 13, or x squared plus 3,000,002 would all have derivatives of 2x. So the natural questions that mathematicians always ask with these kinds of situations is, if I give you a little f, is there a big F? And if there is, how many of them work? The answer is pretty straightforward. Every continuous function has an antiderivative. We'll see later why that's true. This has to do with integration and the fundamental theorem of calculus. But for now, just bear with me. And then if you have two different functions that both have a derivative of little f, then I claim that the difference between them is a constant. Because if you take the derivative of g minus f, that's g prime minus f prime. So that's little f minus little f, and that's 0. And we proved that the only function, back when we did the mean value theorem, we proved that the only function whose derivative is everywhere 0 is a constant function. So g minus f is a constant. So g must be f plus a constant. So we talk about the antiderivative of 2x is x squared plus a constant. It's not a single function. It's really a family of functions. But x squared is an antiderivative, and so is x squared plus 7, and so is x squared plus 15, so is x squared plus any constant. And that's it. If it's got a derivative of 2x, it's got to be x squared plus a constant. So, we'll talk next time about how to compute antiderivatives. I want to talk about what they're good for. There are plenty of situations in physics where you're given a velocity or you're given an acceleration, and you got to figure out the velocity or the position. So if you throw something up in the air, let's say the velocity is v, gravity pulls it down at a rate of 32 feet per second squared. So let's suppose you throw it up in the air with an initial velocity of 64. It's going up at 64 feet per second. And its acceleration is minus 32. What is v of t? Well, we know that the derivative of v of t is negative 32. So v of t is the antiderivative of negative 32. And that's negative 32 t. That's a function whose derivative is negative 32 plus a constant. And the way we figure out the constant is we plug in the value of v at 0. We say 64 is v at times 0 is negative 32 times 0 plus c is c. So that implies that c is 64. And from that, we figure out that the velocity at all time is 64 minus 32t. Now you might go further and say, what is the position? How high are you off the ground if you started off 100 feet above the ground? So you're 100 feet above the ground, you throw something upwards at 64 feet per second, where will it be t seconds later? You've got its velocity, and you know that the derivative position is velocity. So x of t must be the antiderivative of velocity. And we have to find a function whose derivative is 64 minus 32t. Minus 16t squared does the job. The derivative of 64t is 64. The derivative of negative 16t squared is negative 32t. And we have to figure out the constant. How do you figure out the constant? Plug in the initial value. 100 is the value at time 0. That's 64 times 0 minus 16 times 0 squared plus c. So that's c. So c is 100. And now we've got our answer. Our position at time t is 100 plus 64t minus 16t squared. So from the acceleration, physics tells us our acceleration. From the acceleration and the initial velocity, we took an antiderivative to figure out the velocity for all time. From the velocity at all time and the initial position, we took an antiderivative to figure out the position for all time. One last problem. Suppose I gave you a particle that's moving with velocity 5 sine of t and initial position 7. We know that the derivative of the position is the velocity. So our position is something whose derivative is the sine. We know that the derivative of negative cosine is sine. So this is an antiderivative. It's not necessarily the one we want. The one we want is that plus a constant. How do we figure out the constant? Plug in 0. So 7 is x at time 0 is minus 5 cosine of 0 plus our constant. Cosine of 0 is 1, so this is negative 5 plus a constant, implies that our constant is 12. The constant isn't the same thing as the initial position. The initial position was 7, the constant is 12. The constant is whatever you have to plug in order to get the initial position to come out right. So in this case, x of t is 12 minus 5 cosine of t. At time 0, that's 12 minus 5 is 7. It works.